You're not going to want to miss this episode of the AI Show, where Sethu Raman shows us all of the wonders of managed online endpoints in Azure ML. Make sure you tune in. Hello and welcome to this episode of the AI Show, where Sethu Raman is going to tell us some exciting updates for managed online endpoints in Azure ML. Sethu, how are you doing, my friend? Why don't you introduce yourself?
Hey, Seth. Doing great. Happy to be back on the show. So my name is Sethu Raman. I'm the PM product manager for the managed online endpoints in Azure ML.
Fantastic. So last time we talked a little bit about this feature. Can you get us caught up on what the feature is and maybe what's happened since?
Absolutely. So quick recap on the feature, on the capability for your viewers, Seth. So managed endpoints give users the ability to bring their ML models and deploy it in scale across CPU and GPU machines in a turnkey way. So they don't need to worry about the infrastructure. The system takes care of serving, scaling, securing, and monitoring your ML deployment. So that's what the whole feature is about. And so today we are excited to, so last week we launched a bunch of new features, and I want to share that today in the show. First one is auto-scaling. So users now have the ability to right size their deployments and reduce cost by using both schedule based and metrics based scaling. So this has been one of the most asked features from our customers. So that's something that we have released. And we also have released ML flow model format deployment. So if you have a model for ML flow model format, you can deploy it without any code. We call no code deployment, so that is supported. We also support now deploying auto ML models in a no code way in our managed endpoint. So this is supported as well. And other than these, we're also lighting up two new features. One is for interactive debugging of models before you deploy it in production. Okay. And then the second part is like a automated CICD safe rollout, capability.
I mean, there's a ton of things. Like, some of them were super interesting to me. Well, all of them are, but one that was most interesting to me was this notion of debugging. So I'm really interested in seeing how this works. Can you show us a little bit about how one might go ahead and use some of these features in an end-to-end solution?
Absolutely, Seth. So let me bring up my screen here. All right. So in this, the user story that I want to show here is somebody wants to deploy a new model into production without disrupting the current model deployment that is already running. So that's the user story. Of course, as step one, we need to develop when we talk about a new model, it can be changed to the model itself, or it can be changed to the code that you might have for feature engineering, right? Your scoring code or the environment. So in this case, I'm going to start with an example of changing the feature code and then how we launch a new model. So let's start with the first part of it. So here I'm going to execute a CLI command. Here you can see I'm saying, hey, AzureML online deployment and create. You've seen this before from the previous show. And here we are specifying the deployment configuration file that has pointers to that has information on where is your code, what's your model, and the environment details, and then the endpoint name. So this is pretty standard on how you create it in the cloud. Now you have these two flags that we are passing. When we say dash dash local and dash dash VS Code debug, what's going to happen is the whole setup in terms of the whole image is going to be downloaded. Your model is going to be downloaded to be debugged locally. So let me just show what happens now. So when I click this, it's going to create the environment locally within a Docker container here, and it's going to launch VS Code that has access to all your code and all your dependencies. So that's what's happening right now.
So just a quick question, what kind of things are in the deployment.yaml file?
So three things primarily. I would say it has your code, where your code is, what your code is. It has your configuration of the deployment itself, like how many nodes, what is this queue you want, how many nodes you want. And then it has information on your model, which model you want to deploy, what's the version, and what's the environment details. So these are the things that are abstracted in the YAML.
So basically, it's a description of how this model needs to be run.
Exactly.
Okay, cool. And so when you're building these models, you mentioned that there's this codeless way to do it. what kind of code do you have to bring if you're making your own model? And then when we talk about the ML flow models, why is it that those ones are special?
Yeah, awesome. So let's take the question first, where what kind of, if you want to write code, what kind of code you need to write? So this is a sample code, right? So here you see we have a score.py. We expect two functions. One is the init function. The other one is the run function. The init function is run once when the model is loaded, when your container starts. And then the run function is run every time you do a scoring operation. So here, for typically people do cache their model into memory and stuff like that. And here, when the request comes in, you will apply feature engineering and do stuff and return your response, right?
So hit control plus on this so they can be a little bit bigger? There you go. So, okay, now I'm seeing it. So the first function basically loads up the model because it's always just a file. And that only happens once at the beginning. And then the run is every time there needs to be inference. That's what's happening.
You got it, sir. Yes. Okay. Okay. And you can have a bunch of dependencies. In the simple example, I was score.py, but a lot of our users can have like tens or 50, whatever, hundreds of files, dependencies here. So that's all perfect. So this is way of doing things with code, right? Then you have an option where you don't need to do code, what we call no code deployment. So if you have ML flow case, we ML flow supports different flavors. So you can bring in like scikit-learn, PyTorch, TensorFlow, all of these models, you can bring this in. And it's packaged as an ML4 format. And when you deploy this, we take care of the scoring logic so that the user need not write any code there. Similar for our auto ML case as well. You just bring the model, and when you register the model, you set the model format as MLflow. And then when you deploy it, everything is just taken care of.
Because MLflow and AutoML have a notion of like how the model was built. And so they have notions on how the models can be executed. But if you want to build your own model, you would write a script like this run script that we're looking at right here. All right. So what are we looking at right now?
So here we are looking at, so what we want to do, as I was saying, I'm changing some of the code and I want to release a new version of the deployment without disrupting the current version to make sure everything is good. Right. So here, let's assume that I've done some feature engineering code changes. And let's add something here to debug this. So I want to debug this and see if everything is okay. So here I'm just adding one extra statement here to say that, hey, model is loaded correctly, model loaded, right? And all I need to do is, I just need to start the debugging here. So everything is loaded all, when you executed the command, like the AzureML deployment create, you just added a flag for local VS Code debug. And that's all we did. Now it's automatically launched the VS Code and I have a breakpoint set and I started the debugger. And you can see that the breakpoint is right now here. I can interactively debug this. So here I can see it's executed this and I'm going to do this. Then you can actually see the model is loaded. So each and every line you can track the logs here and you can put breakpoints in any of your nested code and you can just interactively debug this.
So that's interesting. One of the problems I always have is I always get these things to run locally, but then it fails to run in the cloud because I might be missing something. How is this helping me with moving it to the cloud?
Yeah, awesome question, because I know you know, like in the initial testing phases, you've been working with us very closely. So the whole idea is that's why you have this concept of local endpoint. It's downloading the whole environment is packaged as a Docker. So you when you test it locally, you have the confidence that everything is working and updated and then test it again. Once everything is done, then you deploy it in the remotely. You can expect that everything will work. So you save that time, that few minutes every time to deploy it remotely and wait.
So this right here that you're debugging is running as if it were in the cloud in the same environment, the same Docker container. Is that what this is doing right now?
Yes.
Oh my goodness. Oh, so see, this is the thing where, because it all started up so fast and I was blathering with you and then we ran it. I thought, because I run stuff on my local machine all the time, but this is running inside of a container exactly the same way it would run in the cloud, correctly? Is that correct?
Exactly, Seth. And in fact, in your deployment.yaml, if you mentioned like, hey, this is my model and this is my environment, all of those are packaged and available for you to run here. So, yes.
Oh, my goodness. So now I can, with confidence, know that it's running, number one. And number two, know that it will run correctly. If there's any errors, I can suss them out before they get up into the cloud. Is that right?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Even after we do this, though, there might be some weirdness when I deploy to the cloud. The one thing that I think is important is, how does someone do this safely? And that's another challenge, I think, because we don't want to just replace whatever endpoint there is. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, absolutely. So if you recall the last time we discussed, we have the concept of like an endpoint and deployments. Multiple deployments can be underneath an endpoint. And then I'm just going to show that what happens here. So let's, why don't we go to the next steps and I show instead of I talk. So let's here we are done with this debugging. Everything is good. Now let's kind of push this in and see what happens. So we just need to commit this. Let's push it to our Git. I created a new feature branch to do this. Now I can just do Git push. And now let's open the repo and merge this code and see how the whole thing is going to work. So let's see if this is done. Okay, all our changes are pushed. Let's create a pull request and merge this code. Oops, I didn't merge it.
That's okay. We can do it again. Go down and reopen the pull request. There you go. Reopen pull request.
And then merge it. So now what's going to happen is this has triggered because we merged to main. This will trigger a run here. So you can see this is GitHub Actions. This is a CICD engine, very similar to what if you use Azure DevOps or any other GitLab or any other CICD engine, it's very similar to that. And now you see that since we've merged it, a GitHub action has been kicked off. So this is going to do a safe rollout. And you can see just started this to a step-by-step rollout. I'm going to show you, since it's going to take a little bit of a time, I wanted to show you something that has already run recently. Okay, so what has happened is it is going to create a new deployment under the endpoint. So an endpoint is already running in production with one deployment that is taking traffic. Now we're creating a new deployment here. That's what this step of the GitHub action of the CI/CD workflow does. And next step, you can see that we do, after we roll out, we do sanity checking. Without even opening live traffic, you can actually hit the deployment directly to see if things are working, and you can test this. And now if we open 10% of the traffic, live traffic that is coming in to this deployment. And after some time, we can validate. So you can open this and you can take this for 5 minutes, 10 minutes. Some of our users wait for a day before they do kind of a rollout to make sure all this are good. What do we mean by all this? In this specific example, I have two cases I'm checking. I'm checking whether there are no errors. When I open the traffic, there's no error to the deployment. That means there is no 3xx or 4xx HTTP codes or 5xx, right? It's only 2xx there. And similarly, we make sure the latency is within an X millisecond, whatever your threshold is. If these two are true, assume these are like your validation gates, release gates, then it goes to the next step. It opens 50% traffic and it can wait for an arbitrary amount of time. And then this is opened up. And similarly, we check, do the validation, and then we open 100% traffic and wait for whatever time that needs to be done. And then finally, when we are super confident everything is good, we can delete the old deployment. So that's kind of the flow that a safe rollout looks like. And how this is made possible is by integrating with our metrics. So when I say latency is within X milliseconds, we validate here. There is a GitHub action here that people can reuse that goes and checks that for this, the metrics that are published are within, in the Azure Monitor, are within X milliseconds. So that's how we may validate all of this, Seth.
I mean, this is really cool. It basically, what you're doing is when you check in code, is it rerunning the entire training process and then producing a model? Did I see that right?
So it can be configured in many ways. So why don't I show you the... why don't we show you some of the, if we go here. So it shows the flow.
There you go.
Yeah, is it okay, Seth, if I do a quick recap of what we all saw?
Yeah, absolutely. Because I think like the process, showing it actually running was really cool, but I want to make sure it's crystal clear what is actually happening.
Yeah, absolutely, Seth. So this is the concept of endpoint and deployment, right? So you have an endpoint. An endpoint is an abstraction where the security is there, SSL is terminated, and you have a stable URI for clients to reference. And then you can have more than one deployment underneath an endpoint. So in this example, you have like two, and one is running CPU, another running three GPU SKUs, and you can have arbitrary amount of traffic between these two. But if we go below, let's look at how the whole safe rollout concept works. So we have like version N of a deployment currently running in production that's taking 100% of the traffic. And slowly, and then we launch like VN plus one, the new deployment in our case, which we just launched when I changed the code, it created a new version of the deployment. And I'm testing with 0% traffic. Then we open more traffic, more and more traffic. And also there is documentation on how we do this, like using tags to track which version of the which deployment is prod and which is like a release candidate. So there is docs on this. I would encourage people to go through. But if you look at the safe rollout, to answer your question, Seth, you know, how we have kind of laid out the pipelines in this repo. This is the key pipeline, right? This is a safe rollout pipeline. And it can be triggered in multiple ways. So one way is a training pipeline runs. And the training pipeline itself can be triggered when a schedule based or a data set is updated and so on. And then the training pipeline can register a model that can kick off safe rollout. Or you register or you directly merge to main. So in our case, if you notice, I did not change the model at all. I just changed the code. Maybe some feature engineering code is changing. Some code optimization is done. Even this can be a new deployment, right? So this is what the example we saw. But in this repo, we have examples where you can kick this off and you can see this as well. And the safe rollout itself, you can see the steps that we saw. We first create a deployment and sanity test it. Then we roll out 10% traffic to it and more traffic, right? But the key thing is you can see this approval gate at every step. We have an automated approval in this case. But easily you can add a manual approval as well if you wish. So that's our story.
This is really cool because like ignorantly I was like, oh, you changed some code and we got to redo the model. But the reality is that in some cases you're changing the inference code. There's no need for model changes. So this kind of pipeline, these kinds of pipelines enable you to rapidly iterate that way as well. Am I getting this a little bit better?
That's perfect. Yeah, that's perfect understanding.
Well, this has been awesome. Where can people go to find out more about these cool things?
So we have like three call to action links that are going to be shared as a part of this. So one of them is this this repo, the link to the repo people share. People can actually go and fork this. They don't need to even download the code or create a Python environment, anything locally. They just need to fork this repo and use some environment variables to point to their workspace and stuff, and they can get going. And then there's one more blog that we are sharing as a part of this AI show where people can go and read about all the new features that I talked about, like auto-scaling, ML4 integration, and all of that, AutoML integration. There are tutorials that people can go through for each of these capabilities.
Awesome. Well, I put them up below. And then if you want to get started, there's a link right down below, Online Endpoints, get started. Sethu, this has been amazing. Thank you so much for being with us, my friend.
Oh, thanks for having me, Seth. Always glad to be here.
Awesome. Well, we've been learning all about Managed Online Endpoints, some of the new goodness. Thank you so much for watching. Hopefully, we'll see you next time. Take care.